Welcome to Building the Green Energy Hub. We'd like to introduce you to the Green Energy Hub, which is the next version of the Data Hub in Denmark. I'm Skovgaard, Enterprise Architect at the Danish Transmission System Operator Energinet, and I have my colleague with me.
Martin Hansen, I'm the System Architect for the Green Energy Hub at Energinet.
The key vision of Energinet is green energy for a better world. This is founded in the realization of the importance of the power grid in the transition towards a carbon-free society. The introduction of renewable production based on wind and solar has helped us up to now, but we realize that in order to be successful in achieving the ambitious goals of decarbonizing power in Denmark, we need to incentivize flexibility on the consumer side in order to match demand with production. This will include sector coupling, flexible consumption, and new digital business models. The Danish power market was deregulated way back in 1999, with a full opening allowing end consumers to change their balance supplier from 2003. In order to lower the entry-level barrier for the market actors, because at that time, every market actor, every balance supplier had to make direct B2B integrations with every single grid in Denmark, and there are more than 100 of those, it was decided to introduce a central communication hub, the data hub, which would act as a mediator between the regulated entities, the DSOs, and the market, the balance suppliers. This went into operation in 2013 and formed the foundation for the next major release in 2016 that we refer to as the supplier-centric model, where the end consumer only need to communicate with their balance suppliers and where all the settlement processes are handled by the data hub. In line with the EU directive on implementation of smart meters, all Danish consumers are now settled on an hourly basis. This will change to 15 minutes with the introduction of the new balancing model in a few years. With the Green Energy Hub, we want to introduce the scalability to handle the massively increased amount of data from hourly settlement, whilst at the same time being able to present data in new ways, supporting digital business models as well as future regulatory requirements. The Data Hub is a center of communication between all major actors in the power grid, production units, grid operators, and balance suppliers, with the consumer in focus. It is our aim to build a flexible implementation that is sufficiently generic to be relevant in all deregulated energy markets. Following prior work in the Smart Grids Task Force, as well as follow-up on the Clean Energy Package from the European Commission, we are seeing a potential for legislative requirements for providing end consumers with free access to the data based on interoperable data formats. The Green Energy Hub is a natural single point of truth for these data, and we believe that it would be a formidable foundational building block for any EU member state that wishes to implement a central solution to support these future requirements. Currently, we support the My Energy Data format for end consumers accessing their own data in settlement quality with the current version of Data Hub, which will be the first starting point for the Green Energy Hub. These are an overview of the core processes that are needed in a deregulated energy market. So what we want to achieve now is to facilitate co-creation as a foundation for accelerated development. The open source community has shown itself capable of establishing fruitful communities in all major industries, even among direct competitors. We are sharing the Green Energy Hub for the mutual benefit of all consumers and parties in the domain. We believe that the best ideas come from the open collaboration of a diverse crowd. And now we'll turn to look at what's actually under the hood of the Green Energy Hub. So let's jump out from the ivory tower and into the engine room of the Green Energy Hub. So over to Martin.
Thank you, Fedder. I will tell you about the architectural thoughts behind the Green Energy Hub. Today, we have the data hub is more or less a monolith. So we are moving from a monolith to a microservice architecture, where we utilize the benefits of microservices for better scaling and more robust operating, where parts of the system can be taken out of service without the entire system is down. We are moving from a traditional data center solution focused on servers and operating systems on a physical location into a cloud architecture, where we use cloud services without the need for dedicated servers, but rather relying on the cloud infrastructure to enable us to scale appropriately. Using the cloud means that we can get started without investing heavily in infrastructure at startup time, as would be necessary in a traditional data center. This also applies for new partners that want to be part of the Green Energy Hub. The basic concept behind the architecture, we are striving for a cloud agnostic architecture. We aim for as little dependence on the cloud providers as possible. We implement a domain-driven design where areas of the project is developed in its own domain, making it independent of the architecture of the other domains. We are focused on scalability and high performance, enabling Green Energy Hub to grow with the increasing amount of data the future brings. The architecture can, in a very simplified form, be divided into three layers. So we can start at the bottom, or if we start at the bottom, we have the core. Here's all the functionality that are platform agnostic. If possible, we are choosing products that are cloud agnostic. In the middle, we have the cloud specific layer. Energinet has decided to implement Green Energy Hub in Asia, meaning that parts of the Green Energy Hub is developed for Asia. Other cloud providers can be included later on, but by other contributors. The market specific layers, where message formats and validation rules specific to the market is, this is not meant to be part of the open source project, but Energinet would publish how we implemented it at Energinet. Here are some of the key domains of Green Energy Hub. To the right, we have the market adapter, where we have two domains for handling incoming messages before it is translated into an internal SIM-based format. So in Energinet, we are currently using EBIX. So, and that is then transformed into an internal SIM-based format with the SIM domain model. When it's transformed into SIM, then the messages can be shipped to the other domains. At the validation and process and stores, we have charges domain where prices, fees, and subscriptions are handled, and all the processes around that. Then we have market roles that handle handles the harmonized market roles and processes. Time series retrieves, validate, and stores the time series values. Market evaluation points handle the processes and maintains information of the market evaluation point. Then we have calculation and reporting, where message validation reports is a central storage of the message validation results. So whenever a domain receives a message and validates it, then the result of the validation is stored at this message validation reports. And so whatever message you have received, you can see if it's approved or or rejected and why. Then you have data request which handles requests for data from individual domains. So you can request data in there, and then this domain is responsible for selecting data from the other domains and shipping it. Then we have settlements. It performs the settlements for each market evaluation point, which can then be forwarded to the balance supplier for invoicing. If we look into one domain, the domain of market rules, Feder showed us earlier some of the processes that are key to the Danish market. And the market rules has the supported processes you see to the right. And basically, the boxes with the text in it, that's other domains. So that's data either from the another domain or to another domain. And when you receive a message from the market through the API gateway domain, which is called here, then it's shipped to a function that through a shared resources domain is transforming the message into an internal SIM format for further processing and also doing some basic evaluation or validation of the message. And the results of the validation is then shipped to the validation reports domain and shipped further out to the to a message queue where another function can take this message and say, a function for, let's say, change of supplier can say, okay, I have a message here with a change of supplier. I need to do something with that. And when the process then is done, the data can is stored in a SQL server and the message can be shipped to the post office, which is the outbound messages channel, and then transformed into the national message format. At the bottom, we have an event queue, again for other domains that wants to listen for the event of we have a change of supplier which is stored in the market rules now, so they can listen on this event and take some action on it if it's needed. We have another domain which is time series. At the top of the drawing, we have some of the entry points from other domains like market rules or market evaluation points. So they can retrieve the data from these domains and store those to use that in processing of time series. So when you receive a time series, it is run through also transforming it into an internal SIM format, then into an event hub. And then we have the Databricks solution. Databricks, that's a third-party tool on Asia, which also works on Amazon or Google Cloud. And we use that to enable us to use Spark to do the calculations of the time series and add the master data of market evaluation points or customers or electrical supplier or prices. So we have all this information we can store together with the time series value. And here we have chosen a Delta Lake. So when the data needs to be fetched from there, then you have all the information you need to do whatever calculation or analytics you need upon that. And of course, there is also a function for when you have change of supplier back in time, you can update the data in the Delta Lake. So you have the recent supplier on the time series values. So you have the correct values. That was it. We are close to publishing this open source project on GitHub under Energinet Data Hub / Green Energy Hub. And you can contact us at any time at the email greenenergyhub@energinet.dk. And now it's time for questions.
So, hello there. Just type ahead if you've got any questions.
And I would like to say that the project went public 25 minutes ago.
So if...
Hello there.
Why, hello there.
So everything is okay?
Yes, I actually think you're on live.
Well, I love that. Five minutes of fame or
a famous last words, I'm not sure.
Exactly. All right. I'll just leave Thanks, you guys Kevin. Again.
We don't have any prizes for the first pull request, but
that question in Q&A.
Ah. That is correct, Laurent. You know me well enough to fight my battles. So reading between the lines in your question, we use the concepts from the sim and not specific profiles internally. So we use the terms and domains and things like that to make sure that it's super easy to transform messages to the actual exchange formats. And I think we can safely say that we are currently investigating opportunities for actually creating profiles using the European style market profile that you mentioned for data exchange in the Danish market. Yeah. And Sebastian asks, what are the main stakeholders? So the primary use cases are chains of supplier, so keeping track of master data of metering points and settlement. And
yeah, but the stakeholder, that would be TSOs.
In the Scandinavian countries, it's the TSOs that typically run this, because they have this market facilitation obligation, whereas in continental Europe, it's typically associations of grid of DSOs. So they're building a hub sort of thing in Belgium, and there it's an association of DSOs called Atrias that is running it. They're looking at building a hub in Poland, and that's the TSOs running it. So whether the hub is fully centralized or decentralized?
How to answer that?
Well, the thing is that the communication pattern of the hub is that it is a central point between to all the grid access providers or DSOs, the entities that collect metadata. They collect all the metadata from whatever meters is in the region, is put into the hub, and then stakeholders that are interested in metadata for whatever reasons, that could be balance suppliers and consumers, whatnot, grid operators. They get the metadata from the hub. So you would think of it as a single in a market. So Martin, I think this is for you. Does the architecture allow for energy communities and integration of two-way services such as flexibility? How easy is it to onboard and interface a new service to the platform?
Basically, if you describe a service as a domain, then as the domains makes events when requested, then it should be fairly easy to make a pull request with a new service for the platform that interacts with all the other domains.
And then a right honorable gentleman called John Donnelly have a question. What are the key areas you want to work with?
Next.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have worked with this project for what is it, 9 months now?
Yeah.
3 months together with Microsoft. And currently we the time series modules is not done, but it is almost there. Currently we are not working on that until next around the summer holiday. We are implementing the processes of getting things about market evaluation points, creating market evaluation points, updating master data on that at the moment, as well as we have implemented move in, move out, or parking. So of course, all the processes that we have that is needed for building the market. That is where we are working right now. And of course, if people are interested in participating in this, a pull request would be very grateful for that.
And you would say another area and an area where I think quite a few European countries would benefit on the relatively short time frame is for providing end consumers with access to their own data. The thing is that you need to handle consent, and that is always a rather tricky thing to do that. And since metadata is personally identifiable information, there are quite a lot of regulatory requirements on how to do that. And in our opinion, the most efficient way of providing end consumers with an access to their own data in a scalable and, you could say, in on a platform that is more or less free of licenses, is actually to make an instantiation of the Green Energy Hub in your market area, and then use that, hook it up with your local national ID service, and then use that for exposing consumption data to end users. And we would very much like to collaborate with people from other markets on doing that. Can you post a link to GitHub? Indeed I can. So now I'm asking myself a question, but there you go. The most challenging part was, well,
I think that yeah, one of the most challenging part was to figure out how to solve this in Asia, and choosing all the technologies.
Yeah, it helps having good friends and good advice. And then I would say it's also to change the culture of the company. This is the first major open source project that Energinet does. And that has been a not completely straightforward process to go from the concept phase to actually opening the GitHub repository. But we're here, and we now have an open source strategy at Energinet, and we are a proud general member of the Linux Foundation Energy, and we hope that we can that this project can help us in achieving a greater maturity with regards to both absorbing and contributing to open source in the energy domain. So if somebody got a really finicky question for the last 4 minutes, then that's your chance to fry us. If you were to do it today, would you do it differently?
No, I don't think so. If we were to do it today, we hopefully had a business where the business knew what open source is, so we would have gone open source before. But
it's a journey.
Yes.
And then you cannot just jump to the end. You have to walk the whole Camino. It doesn't work to do helicopter. just fly there and then base jump. I think you have to go through the whole thing. Oh, great. Thanks, Stephen. Well, thanks, Julie. I'll leave that to Martin on when to put it under the umbrella of LF Energy.
I think you have a chat with the managing director of Data Hub, Julie. I think that he's the one that are pulling the strings there.
I hope the project conforms to the principles of the Technical Advisory Council of LF Energy. Yeah, that was an internal joke. Thanks to all who helped. You know who you are. And it is actually with quite an honor to be able to provide this project to the community. And we do look really much forward to being in contact with you all. And I think our time's up, more or less.
So, thank you for watching.
Done? Yeah. I wonder if we are kicked out or how it works.